Even though I found this very valley, I am now forgotten, just like the breeze of the buffalo. Following the prosperous rendezvous, back to the mountains I headed. But after a very long, hard winter, warmer weather beckoned me. So I headed south. That's when I found them, a small group of wagons, more than half starved and running, two already dead and one sick, the Indians close behind. I roamed these mountains for many years with nary a problem, but I guess I knew not to settle. I made them leave me the extra guns, powder, and ammo. It was more than enough for the small band of warriors. I slay all but one. He got me with his knife before I could finish him. I died there, bleeding from the chest. All that remains of me is a small stone, although it does not have my name. Just three men killed by Indians.
Never in my time here have I had a single regret. When my husband and I arrived at our prized, beautiful homestead, it was nothing, just a meadow of wildflowers. Every season had so much beauty, the flaws wisped away. In the spring, the little deer dawdling about the wildflowers. The summer brought days of sun and warmth. The leaves turning to colors of auburn and gold in the fall. Wintertime brought peaceful snow falling to the ground. As the seasons changed slowly, my beautiful life did as well. Nothing came easy, but nothing easy is worth it. Working and working, we made a living. Our vision of a home soon became a reality. We started our family and flourished. Children came, 7 of 10 lived, and we were blessed. In my later days, as I strolled through the wildflowers, I looked back at my life and realized how lucky I was to live in this heavenly place. We knew the secret of life. Everything is worth it as long as you're happy.
I was the man who lived two lives. The man that locked people behind bars and the man that had an addiction to alcohol. Life till 20 was a blast, locking people up and drinking till drunk. I was having the best times of my life with my friends as well. Then my way of living seemed to vanish. Prohibition started and I was infuriated, but I wasn't going to let the law stop me, and I didn't. Most of my life then was spent in the Sierras, in the forest. I had a secret storage in my cellar, so I transported that to the mountains. Then one day, my best friend became my worst enemy. The fight occurred by the talk of alcohol. He confessed to telling the authorities about my illegal habits. I was enraged and we broke into a fist fight, but he sent me seeing stars. By daylight the next day, I was on the ground. I took a sip of whiskey to clear my head. I realized the bottles were shuffled after I took the sip. Then I fell again, and my soul rose to heaven.
I was a sheep herder till the day I went wrong. It all started when I got lazy with my flock. But oh man, was that the biggest mistake of my life. I was alone, with just my son, my sheep, and my neighbor John, who was a cattle driver. John and I were friends till the incident. It was a night that was cold and windy with a full moon. My sheep came out of the pasture and tore up his grazing land. After it happened, all I heard was my neighbor John yelling. My son came out to calm him down. When I came outside, I saw John pointing a gun at me and my son. I was yelling, "You drop that gun right now or you will pay." I didn't get an answer until he shot me and my son. As I was dying, I was screaming at the top of my lungs, "I am sorry, my son."
I was part of the fairest haggerty line. My dog never left my side. She was with me through everything. She was the oxygen to my fire. She was the reason that I lived life. As my dog and I were walking to town for supplies, a club knocked me in my head before I could react. My constant companion of 14 years was killed trying to protect me. Later, I saw the man out walking the streets drunk. I avenged her. With a swing of a fist, the man hit the dirt like a sack of flour. I drug him to a soft spot in the ground and buried him. I could hear him trying to breathe through the dirt. He couldn't. The law wasn't too happy with me since then, but they never had proof. One day, I was in a mine alone, closing down for the day. It seemed I was blinded because it was pitch black. I could only see the pickaxe outline. I had forgotten my lantern. And suddenly, I could see my dog again. The light around her was so bright. I followed her. I followed the light. I am forever living in peace with her.
I was a rigid shadow, nothing but a monster to behold. Didn't learn how to ask the complication until it was too late. It happened like this. I was a blacksmith alongside my brother. We had just inherited the shop from our folk. We'd yet to think of about a vivid composition for our tools. So in turn, I tripped on the very things we had yet to put away. I hit my head on our dousing bucket and fell into the forge. At that moment, I was set ablaze. My brother grabbed a bucket filled with oil and poured it on me. After that, I was a human torch. And when the smoke cleared, I was just a pile of ash floating away.
There was a vast quantity of ways it could have happened. Old age, sickness, suicide, or even debasing his body's integrity. But it had to happen in the most sickening way achievable. The townspeople didn't believe that it was a mishap, but maybe I kid myself as he was tight-fisted towards me. Could my subconscious mind have caused me to harm my kin? Who's to say? I thought I was an acceptable human. But they threw me in the jailhouse, and before my trial even began, I breathed my final breath due to heart failure. It was the pressure, I suppose.
Coming from. I stared at the cloud of smoke. There was something about it that just caught my eye. That's when it happened. I didn't see it, I just felt it. Mr. and Mrs. Blaine came running at me. I looked under the horses. All I saw was those blue, lifeless eyes. I didn't know what to do. People rejected me after that. I went from the town favorite to the town's most hated person. I couldn't live with myself. I couldn't live with the fact that I took an innocent life. All I could imagine was Mrs. Blaine's screams, Mr. Blaine's curses, townspeople's voices in my head. So I went into the forest, deep into the forest with a gun, and ended it all.
I was born an only child, and adventure was always at hand. My parents argued a lot, and I didn't like it. My father worked as a copper miner when the boom hit. He didn't get much time off, but one summer day, he was free for a whole day. We rode in the wagons all the way up into the mountains. My mother packed us a lovely picnic. We sat to eat when suddenly my parents started to argue. My father didn't like his job and he was complaining. My mother didn't like it when he complained. I saw a beautiful blue and white butterfly in the midst of everything. I found myself running after the small wings that fluttered. I chased that butterfly all the way into the road. Just then, a glittering stone caught my eye. I bent over to pick it up. The sound of hooves seemed to surround me. My heart skipped a beat. Those horses came barreling towards me, hauling a logger's wagon driven by Peter Birch. I don't remember the pain. It all happened so quickly. I just lay there lifeless in the road, my blue eyes cold as ice. I was just 5 years old, and that butterfly led me to my grave.
Dr. Monahan, the new physician, sat ahead only a little while. I was heartbroken because I was leaving everyone I loved, and I didn't want to harm anyone, so I did not breathe a word about my illness. People thought I was happy being 18, but they didn't understand that I'd leave this world soon. Why did my life have to end so quickly? I have to say that I'm jealous of those who live longer than I. I stole your heart, and you asked for my hand, but I had to decline due to my illness. I saw your heartbreak then, and I'm sorry. I dreamed about living the rest of my life with you, but I knew I was destined for a coffin. I watched the stars, hoping that you would understand. And as I gazed at the stars for the last time, I faded away, carrying your heart.